Before we begin, I would like to advertise my books, Above Heaven and Dance of Frozen Death. If you like my takes on storytelling, please consider giving them a read. Links in the description. Now, on with the video.
This is worthless.
It's less than worthless, my boy.
Greetings, fellow mortals. I would just like to say that everyone who says it's just my opinion is a coward. This is not my opinion. What I'm about to say are facts. Fight me in the comment section. Go on, I dare you. Now, I have watched more Gravity Falls than I ever expected to. I revealed the show to my wife back in 2020 because we were trapped in the house and needed something to distract us. Thankfully, she adored everything about the cartoon, to the point that we have watched the show several times over and she got into the habit of listening to it on her phone as she fell asleep. I have heard the entirety of her favorite episode, The Hand That Rocks the Mabel, more times than I can count. I could probably quote it more than any other episode, even though it's not my favorite. As such, I have an in-depth knowledge of every little single thing that happens in the show. I have seen every corner, mistake, joke, and character development so much to the point that I was sick of this show at one point, especially one particular episode. The one episode where every time it popped up after the first couple of viewings, I looked to my wife and asked if we could skip it. Thankfully, she always agreed because she didn't like it either, because this is the single worst episode of Gravity Falls. Roadside Attraction is the lowest point in the entirety of the series. It's a gaping wound in the side of something beautiful.
And notice it bald, bald,
One of the worst parts of this episode is its placement in the show as a whole. This is the final episode before the series finale begins. The momentum is grinded to a halt. It's also right after the funniest episode in the series, The Last Mabel Corn. No one wanted this part of the story at all. It feels as filler and out of place as it can possibly get. Even less popular episodes like Boys Crazy at least fit better into the timeline. You could take Roadside Attraction out of the equation entirely, and you wouldn't know the difference other than the fact that season 2 didn't have 20 episodes like the first season did. Seriously, I can just picture the pitch in the writer's room. The Last Mabel Corn was done and they had to think of something else to do to buy time before the series finale. So they suggested a road trip. That's fun, that won't get in the way, but that leads to another problem. Why would any of the Pines leave the Mystery Shack while Bill was still active? The whole point of the unicorn hair was to protect their home. That way Bill couldn't get to them. Even if you use the excuse that Ford wanted them away for a short period of time to fix things, it's pretty stupid. It doesn't fit in with the plot or character development at all. Ford wanted Dipper as his protege, after all, and Ford wasn't even mentioned at all in this episode, making this seem like it was aired out of order. Overall, it doesn't make sense.
That does not make sense!
And finally, we get to the overall story. The entire audience groaned along with the other characters when Dipper's crush on Wendy was brought up again. No one wants to hear him angst about this anymore. We're past that. There was already planned closure in the storyline soon enough anyway. So the entire plot doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. It focuses on stuff that no one cares about anymore, and it gets in the way of the grand finale everyone was waiting for. The writers put themselves into a death spot, one of which they probably could have thought about a little bit more. If there is any positive about Roadside Attraction, it would be that Grunkle Stan is in fact in this episode. His escapades are the only thing that brings any enjoyment to this part of the story. His pranking the other tourist traps is definitely amusing and hilarious. Plus, his trying to get cozy with the Spider-Woman was a hilarious and terrifying turnaround on the trope that they were already playing with in the episode. If the entire episode was following Grunkle Stan, it would have been much better, especially if it delved into the regret he feels over his previous relationships and how his attitude towards women made a mess out of everything that he's touched. That would have made the episode at least good despite its death spot. Unfortunately, that wasn't the case. Instead, the entire episode was focused on criticizing Dipper for flirting with girls. You know, Dipper, who was never shown to look down on girls, ever, whose entire attraction to Wendy was based on her personality. He didn't exactly go on and on and on about her looks. It was Mabel that did that with boys all the time, but not Dipper. And suddenly, the show is telling me that Dipper's a misogynist. Mostly because of the advice he got from Grunkle Stan. Now, Stan is definitely not the right character to ask for advice on women, but his words weren't exactly out there. It basically boiled down to fake confidence and try to make her laugh until you start feeling more comfortable. And this is treated like the worst thing to ever be said about anything, ever. But this is exactly what I would tell any guy trying to get comfortable around girls. You have to force yourself to talk with them and pretend that you're not currently feeling the urge to vomit with the fear of rejection rolling down your spine. Because while I'm married now, I do remember what it was like in high school, in college, and afterwards. The only way to get comfortable with talking with women is to do it. I remember doing it myself, and Dipper didn't do anything wrong. He didn't say anything mean. He wasn't using the pickup artist lines of insulting people. He was just nice, charismatic, and funny. Dipper didn't even want anything from the girls other than their email addresses. He didn't want to touch them or hurt them or do anything to them. He just wanted to gain some confidence. But no, this is apparently true evil. How dare he talk to girls without the full intention of courting them and dedicating his entire life to them.
Now what's the big idea of that?
I'm ashamed to show my face in public.
And it all accumulates when Mabel's friend Candy decides that she has a crush on Dipper just because he said a few nice things to her. So a group of three girls pressure Dipper into going on a date with Candy when he doesn't feel comfortable with this at all. Then all the girls he flirted with all suddenly appear like wild Pokemon, and each of them act like Dipper did a lot more than talk to them for 5 minutes. They act like he promised to be in a committed relationship with each of them, like they were dating for months and months on end, and then Dipper has to apologize for having the audacity to try to be confident, like he is the problem here. All the while, I'm wondering why I'm supposed to be mad at Dipper. He just got a few emails. He just flirted a bit. They only talked for a few short minutes. What did all of these girls who live very far away from him expect? That they would email each other constantly and have a long-distance relationship at 12 years old? And what about Mabel's group, Reverse the Sexes? Imagine if Dipper and two of his friends pressured Mabel into going on a date that she didn't want. Oh wait, that was already in an episode that my wife made me consume over and over and over again until I have it borderline memorized. And Dipper was the only one in that episode not forcing her to go on a date with Gideon when she didn't want that.
Yep.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I get what they were going for here. This is supposed to be a critique of the pickup artist culture, and that would have worked if the episode was constantly about Stan. Instead, it focused on Dipper, showing him doing the bare minimum to become comfortable around girls. This is a family show comparing innocent flirting with dehumanizing and abusing women. It's almost like cartoons about children shouldn't try to use allegory for sex. It's almost like it doesn't transfer over well and becomes the worst aspect of an entire episode. I wonder if we have more examples of this phenomenon. Now, because a lot of people aren't generous at all with their interpretations of what people say, I hereby scorn and disown all of the pickup artist nonsense. No one should use women for their bodies. No one should manipulate and gaslight other people. No one should approach another person with the intention to manipulate them. obvious statement is obvious. There is a wide distance between that and just talking to a girl to overcome social anxiety. That's why focusing on Stan's issues would have made the episode a lot better. Personally, I just think that the creators were too focused on what was coming after this to think about this pile of garbage.
I'm going to give you a super F.
It's not like there aren't plenty of other ideas that could have been done to fix this and make the episode better. Forget following Stan. What you could have done is just made an entire episode focusing on Bill Cipher. He could be observing people throughout Gravity Falls. Do a bunch of short stories filling in the minor details of everyone we've grown to know and care about in the town. It could fill in the gaps for the finale and give closure to a lot of storylines. Seuss and his girlfriend, Pacifica, blending McGuckick. I could go on and on and on with the small ideas that could be associated with this. I think that it would be a perfect tie-in episode before the end truly begins. Basically, go full 22 short films about Springfield. That episode is considered one of the best in the entire show. So, 22 short films about Gravity Falls could be even better if it helped tie in to the overall plot and branching subplots. It could have been hilarious and heartfelt. It could have theoretically been the most beloved episode in the entire series. Instead, we got the worst. You're welcome to disagree with me about all of this. I don't mind. After all, everyone is entitled to their objectively wrong opinion.
Good Lord, what is happening in there?
Aurora Borealis?
Thank you so much for watching. Please leave a comment down below. I'd love to hear your thoughts and to continue the discussion in the comment section. And please consider giving my books, Above Heaven, Dance of Frozen Death, and Vows of Blood and Honor, which will be released in September, a chance. I appreciate you. Do not despair.